He goes before. I see the shore.
He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God, in Him will I trust. Surely He shall deliver thee from the snare of the fowler and from the noisome pestilence. He shall cover thee with His feathers, and under His wings shalt thou trust. His truth shall be thy shield and buckler. Thou shalt not be afraid for the terror by night, nor for the arrow that flieth by day, nor for the pestilence that walketh in darkness, nor for the destruction that wasteth at noonday. 1,000 shall fall at thy side, and 10,000 at thy right hand, but it shall not come nigh thee. Only with thine eyes shalt thou behold and see the reward of the wicked. Because thou hast made the Lord, which is my refuge, even the Most High, thy habitation. There shall no evil befall thee, neither shall any plague come nigh thy dwelling. For he shall give his angels charge over thee, to keep thee in all thy ways. They shall bear thee up in their hands, lest thou dash thy foot against the stone. Thou shalt tread upon the lion and the adder, the young lion and the dragon shalt thou trample under feet. Because he has set his love upon me, therefore will I deliver him. I will set him on high, because he hath known my name. He shall call upon me, and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble, I will deliver him and honor him. With long life will I satisfy him and show him my salvation.
Unwavering faith. Unwavering faith, Christian Church, Confession of Faith. We are the righteousness of God through Christ Jesus, an heir of God and joint heirs with Christ. We are the body of Christ, fitly joined together for a common cause, and that is to advance the kingdom of God. We are the head and not the tail, above only and not beneath. We are healed, healthy, whole, and complete in all the will of God. We are 100% tithe givers. We bring all the tithe into the storehouse, therefore our barns are overflowing. We have more than enough to meet all of our needs and to be a blessing to others. We pursue Jesus with a pure heart and seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all things are added unto us. We walk by faith and not by sight, and we have an unwavering faith in the Father's love. We are persuaded that nothing can separate us from the love of God. We are the apple of his eye, and we walk in his divine favor. His goodness and mercy follows us all the days of our lives, and we shall dwell in his house forever. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Unwavering faith.
Good evening, good evening, good evening to each and every one of you. To God be the glory. We thank you. We praise God so very much for each one of you being here with us on tonight. We pray that you have had a wonderful day in the Lord, and we pray that you have been walking in God's divine favor, and you have been walking under an open heaven. Amen. And so we are so thankful that you have joined in with us on tonight. We've missed you all. But we're so glad to be back on the air, the airwaves, whatever you want to call it, the live stream. Amen. We're just grateful to be back on tonight. Sheila and I had a much needed respite. We both acknowledged that we didn't know how much we needed that until it actually took place. And so, UFCC, thank you for allowing us that time. We thank you, amen, for carrying on and operating in a spirit of excellence. And to Minister Eric Young, who filled in, occupied the pulpit on this past Sunday, we thank God for you, man of God, and we are so grateful, amen, for your servanthood and for your availability to the things of the kingdom. And again, to the members of UFCC, thank you, amen, for filling in and for, I spoke with Minister Young and he acknowledged how UFCC just took so good care of he and his family. And he has a debt of gratitude for the body of Christ here at UFCC, and we're so thankful for that. Amen. So let us go into the Word of God. On tonight, we're still with the study of Hebrews, so we're going to open up in a word of prayer, and then we'll get right into the study on tonight. And we're going to be starting our study at chapter number 3 on tonight. So, Father, we thank you and we praise you, God, for another opportunity to come before these, your precious sheep, to spread your word, God, to teach and to preach this gospel of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, knowing that it's all about him and it's not about us. We thank you, Holy Spirit, for being the teacher on tonight. We thank you for leading and guiding us into all truth. We thank you, Heavenly Father, for your love, that unconditional love. We thank you for your peace that passes all of our understanding as it guards our hearts and our minds, and for the promise that if we keep our minds stayed on you, you'll keep us in perfect peace. And so we're so grateful and we're so thankful for that. We praise you, God, for being Elohim, El Elyon. We praise you for being El Shaddai. We praise you for being Jehovah Shalom and Jehovah Sitkanu. We praise you, God, for being God all by yourself. We praise you for being the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, the Most High God. There is none above you, Father. And so we magnify your name on tonight. The word declares that you have given unto your Son Jesus the name that's above every name, that at his name every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that he is the Christ, the Son of the living God. And so it's up on that name and it's up on the authority and the power in that name that we bind any and all hindrances from your from this study on tonight, any distractions, God, that will try to keep your people from hearing this word and receiving all that you have for them. We bind it in Jesus' name, and we render it harmless, useless, inoperative, and ineffective in any and every way. And we give you praise and we give you glory in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Go ahead and share and like this broadcast, amen, so that we can have as many people on as possible that they may receive the word of God on tonight. So out of the book of Hebrews, chapter number 3 is where we'll begin our study on tonight. And I'm going to be reading out of the Amplified version of the Bible. Actually, what I'll do is I'll grab my King James here and I'll do the King James, and then we will also use the Amplified version of the word. Since we don't have it on the screen for you tonight, we'll do it that way. Let me just get there in the King James. I'm already there in the Amplified. All right. So Hebrews chapter number 3, and starting our reading at verse number 1 in the Amplified. In the King James. And it says, "Wherefore, holy brethren, partakers of the heavenly calling." I want to point out right from the start again that we are partakers of this gospel. We are partakers in this kingdom walk. We are partakers. We're participators. We're not spectators. We are recipients of, and so we have a right because of what Jesus done and because of us accepting him as our Lord and as our Savior. We are partakers. We're not just bystanders in this. And so that all comes in knowing who we are in Christ Jesus, knowing who Jesus is, and knowing where we are in him. The Bible declares that we are seated together with him in heavenly places. Again, giving notice and giving attention to the fact that we are spirit beings that have a soul and we occupy a body. But when we look at it the way God looks at it, and when we see ourselves the way God sees us, then he sees us as his children, spirit beings. So by that, in the spirit, we are seated together with Christ in heavenly places. We're partakers of this whole thing. And so we can't allow the enemy, the flesh, relatives, or anyone else to minimize who we are in Christ. And we do that humbly. We do that submissively to the will of the Father and to the leading and the guiding of the Holy Spirit. But we boldly declare that we are partakers in the things of God. And so the writer of Hebrews, and we recall who he's writing this to. Remember, we started out by saying he's writing this to a group of religious people, a group of Christians, who are contemplating returning to Judaism. So they're contemplating leaving the things of Christ and returning back to the laws that encompasses Judaism. So the writer of Hebrews is hitting them hard, and he's doing his best to persuade them with the truth, not just with flair and fluff, but to persuade them with the truth of the gospel, of who Jesus is, that is not the best move for them to make, if I can say that in our term. That's not the best move for them to make. And he begins to qualify his reasoning. He begins to qualify his argument. He begins to qualify his urging of these individuals or this group of individuals to stay with Jesus. Okay, to stay with Jesus. Don't draw back. To stay with Jesus. And so here we are now. Verse number one. Wherefore, holy brethren, partakers of the heavenly calling, consider the apostle and high priest of our profession, Christ Jesus. So let's look at this. Remember, we talked about those two prominent figures in Judaism. We spoke about Moses being a type of Christ. And then we spoke about Aaron being the high priest, and he being the founder of the priesthood and the original high priest of the children of Israel. And so now here the writer is, he knows what Judaism is about. He knows what they're going to be facing if they turn back to Judaism. So he's sharing with them, we had and have a high priest in the faith of Judaism. But what I want to submit to you now, what I want to present to you now is Jesus, the Son of the living God, the only begotten of the Father, in whom all of the promises of God are in this man, Christ Jesus. Not only is he the Son of God, but he is the apostle and he is the high priest. So let's look at apostle. So apostle, the Greek word for apostle is apostolos. And it translates to one who is sent out. Jesus here is referred to as the one sent out or sent one of God. So he's saying, you know, we have the apostles, we have the high priest, but I want to introduce to you to the apostle who is sent out by God in this time, this new covenant. This is a better covenant. And the apostle is Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God. And then he goes on and tells them now he is the high priest. So what he's doing is he's showing Jesus compared to Moses, and he's showing Jesus compared to Aaron, the high priest. So the high priest in the Old Testament was a man appointed by God to oversee the tabernacle in the wilderness and a position of sacred responsibility. That's what the high priest had, a position of sacred responsibility. The high priest was appointed by God to oversee the temple. And the priest, the high priest, is of the tribe of Levi. So the high priest was a Levite who made the sacrifice for the people of Israel on the Day of Atonement, interceding on the behalf of sinners. Aaron, the first official high priest. So look at that. The high priest going to make sacrifices on the Day of Atonement and interceding on behalf of sinners. Jesus, our high priest, made the ultimate sacrifice that there no longer has to be an annual Day of Atonement, but Jesus did it one time And he came to save us from our sin while we were yet in our sin. So he took on the sin of the entire world. And once we receive him as our Lord and our Savior, the sin that we carried has been given unto him. And now he has it because he's the only one that can bear it. And so we are I need you to hear me, because I know there's going to be some kickback. I know there'll be some conversation. Hear me when I tell you that because of what Jesus did, paying the ultimate price on Calvary, taking on the sin of the world, and us receiving him as our Lord and our Savior, we become sinless saints of God. I need you to catch that, but I need you to catch that in the spirit. I don't need you looking at this flesh. I don't need you looking at this day-to-day operation. I don't need you looking at the world situation. I don't need you looking at how you stumble. I don't need you looking at how you even fall. I need you to look at what Jesus has already done as our high priest. Oh, my God, my God. I felt that. I just felt that. Look at what Jesus has already done as our high priest. Look at the role of the high priest, to go in and to make atonement for the sin of the people, interceding for the sinner. Jesus, the only begotten of the Father, the Son of the living God, paid the ultimate sacrifice on Calvary's cross. He bore the sin of the world. Jesus, the Bible says this, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth on him shall not perish, but shall have everlasting life. In Jesus taking on the sin of the world, and when we receive him, we are now in Christ Jesus. Come on, stay with me in the spirit. Don't get in the flesh. Don't try to figure this out with your mind. Don't try to don't try to rationalize this in the natural, because you'll never get there. But if you look at this in the spirit, where Jesus is, seated at the in heavenly places with him right now, we are sinless saints because we are in him. So listen to me, saints. The spirit cannot sin. It's the flesh. It's the soul that needs to be saved. I am saved. I've been saved. On the day I made Jesus my Lord and my Savior, I became saved. My soul became saved. My soul is being saved even now, today, and future. My soul will be saved. It's progressive in the soul. But in the spirit, I am flawless. I am faultless. I am pure before my Father, which is in heaven. That's why the enemy tries to get us to turn back, so that we will no longer carry that characteristic of being in the image and the likeness of our Father. Jesus, our apostle, Jesus, our high priest. The word goes on to say in verse number 2, I'm reading out of the King James Version, Hebrews chapter number 3 and verse number 2, goes on to say, who was, speaking of Jesus still, who was faithful to him, who appointed him, as also Moses was faithful in all his house. So what is happening here, the writer is referencing a scripture back in Numbers chapter number 12 and verse number 7. And I want us to see that as he's making reference to Moses being faithful over God's house. Remember, even Paul did it. Paul's writing, even Peter, they always took them back so they were able to see from whence they have come and what God has already done and what God is doing and what God desires to do in their lives. And so, lest we forget where God has brought us from, if not for the grace of God, we see those that may not be where we are, but we've got to remember, but for the grace of God, there go I. But for the grace of God, there we go. And so I love how the writers of the scriptures here in the New Testament refers back every now and again, every so often, to let the people know this is where God has brought us from by and through Christ Jesus, our Lord and our Savior. So in the book of Numbers, Numbers chapter number 12 and verse number 7, I'm going to go there real quick so we can read that as reference has been given to that passage of scripture. And so here we are, Numbers chapter 12 and verse number 7. And this is what it reads out of the Amplified. But it is not so much. Well, let me start. Let me go back to verse number five. I'll go there. I'll start with verse number five. The Lord came down in a pillar of cloud and stood at the doorway of the tabernacle. And he called Aaron and Miriam, and they came forward. And he said, "Hear now my words. If there is a prophet among you, I, the Lord, will make myself known to him in a vision, and I will speak to him in a dream. But it is not so with my servant Moses," look at this, "who is entrusted and faithful in all my house." Do you see that reference? Entrusted and faithful in all my house. So the writer of Hebrews is taking them back to that scripture as a point of reference, because he's getting ready to take them further into the divine revelation. So here we go, back over in Hebrews chapter number 3, verse number 2, out of the Amplified. He was faithful, talking about Jesus. He was faithful to him who appointed him apostle and high priest. That's the Father. So the Father appointed Jesus apostle and high priest. The Father appointed Moses as the prophet, as the deliverer. He appointed Aaron as the high priest. So look at what he says. And he was faithful to him who appointed him apostle and high priest, as Moses also was faithful in all God's house. Yet Jesus has been considered worthy of much greater glory and honor than Moses, just as the builder of a house has more honor than the house. Syl and I live in a D.R. Horton home. The builder is D.R. Horton. And so the model of the home is a Kiowa. If someone asked us about our home and we said we live in a Kiowa, they would probably be confused as to what exactly is a Kiowa. What kind of home is that? But if we say we live in a D.R. Horton home, then people will say, "Oh, okay, all right, D.R. Horton." Or if someone says, "I live in a Stylecraft home," especially here in Texas, I don't know if Stylecraft is nationwide, but I know we have them here. They're prominent in Texas. And so if someone here in Texas say, "I live in a Stylecraft home," then we would say, "Oh, okay, man, they build a great home." So the builder has a greater honor than the home. So I say D.R. Horton, instantly recognized. I say Kiowa, not so much so, unless I'm speaking with someone else that has one themselves, or someone that may own a D.R. Horton home and they themselves looked at a Kiowa, or they know someone that owns one, that model, that style of home. Jesus, my God. Well, let's just see what the scriptures say. Let's just go back to the scripture. Yet Jesus has been considered worthy of much greater glory and honor than Moses. Just as the builder of a house has more honor than the house. The implication is that the covenant established through Jesus' death is more glorious than the covenant established at Mount Sinai. I want to say that again. The covenant that was established by Jesus' death is better, it's more powerful, it's more glorious than the covenant that was established at Mount Sinai. In Jesus Christ, saints of God, we have a much better covenant. In this covenant with Jesus Christ, we are to operate, we have the authority, we have the permission to operate in the liberty whereby Christ has made us free. And so the liberty whereby Christ has made us free keeps us from having to live under and in bondage of the law. You see, because the law, again, only told us how bad we were. It showed us how bad we were. It showed us how shortcoming we were. And for us to revert back to the law would put us in a state of bondage to where Christendom and serving God would become tedious rather than glorious. God never meant for this to be tedious. He always meant for this to be glorious, because he always meant for our attention and our focus to be on his son, Jesus Christ. And so when our hope and our trust and our faith is in Jesus, then, and I'm talking about genuinely, then there is a release that we receive, and there is a freedom that we walk in. There is a heaviness that's lifted from us as we cast all of our cares upon him, because he cares for us. There is a glorious freedom in Christ Jesus that we walk in, that we operate in, and that we have the knowledge and the wisdom to understand that it's not left up to me to try to figure out what only God can work out. In other words, I'm not spending all of my day trying to make it happen. I'm spending my day resting in him, because he has already made it happen. I'm just waiting on it to manifest. Oh, my God, my God. In other words, Jesus has already done it all. He can't give it all to us at one time, because we can't handle it. So what do? We wait and we rest in him until that time comes for the manifestation of whatever it is that we're seeking God for, whatever it is that we're believing God for, whatever it is that we're trusting God for. We're just simply awaiting the manifestation of that. And while we wait in anticipation, we wait and we continue to praise God as we wait. We continue to thank God as we wait. We continue to have an attitude of gratitude as we wait. And we continue to live a stress-free life, because our lives are hidden in him. Our lives are hidden in him. Glory to God. Hallelujah. We have a question here. Let's see what the question is. When Jesus told those he healed in John 5 and John 8, go and sin no more, was he referring to the spiritual creature or the fleshly nature? If we are sinners, if we are sinless because he bore the sins of the world, what did he mean by these words? Go and sin no more is just like he would be telling us to go and sin no more. That is to not go and voluntarily practice that which is in direct opposition to what God has already commanded. You see, we are not sinners, but we're in this flesh. We can still sin. That's why I shared at the beginning, look at this in the spiritual realm, because the spirit cannot sin. The spirit man in me cannot sin. It's this flesh and it's this soulish man, the psuche, the soul of man that needs to be saved day by day by day. So go and sin no more means to go and not practice, not voluntarily participate, or not voluntarily practice that which is in direct opposition to God. Because we can sin right now, even with our thoughts, because we're still living in this flesh suit. Okay? Did I answer that for you? Just give me a yay or nay in the comment if I answered that for you. I want to make sure we're all clear before I move on. Good question. Okay, waiting. Okay, I'm going to move on. So we have a far better covenant with Jesus, our Lord and our Savior. Now let me take you back. Let's pick back up now in chapter number 3 of the book of Hebrews. And we are on verse number 5. Did I read number 5? Yeah, verse number 5. And Moses verily was faithful in all his house as a servant for a testimony of those things which were to be spoken for. But Christ as a son over his own house. Now here, look at the comparison. The comparison is Moses was faithful over the house of God, over the tabernacle. Moses was faithful as a servant. Jesus is faithful as a son. Now, I'm getting ready to go deeper into this, and I want you to see the revelation that we're getting ready to see in this passage of Scripture. So, verse number 6, but Christ, as a son over his own house, whose house are we, if we hold fast the confidence and the rejoicing of the hope firm unto the end. Again, do not, child of God, do not draw back. The comparison, Moses, the physical tabernacle. He was faithful over the physical tabernacle as a servant. Jesus is faithful. Man, I love this. I love Hebrews. I love the writer, how he penned this in Hebrews to just bring everything home and to ensure that Jesus Christ was the center and the circumference, the base and the boundaries, the balance and the beauty, the sum and the substance of all that we have and all that we need. He continued to tie it all back to the Son. And so he's saying that Jesus, the Son, is faithful over the house. And we are the house. We are the church. It was the tabernacle back then, the physical edifice. It's the church of the living God now, us. We are the body of Christ. We are the bride of Christ. And he's faithful over his house. He's faithful over his bride. He's faithful to his house. He's faithful to his bride. In other words, he that begun a good work is faithful to complete it. Jesus has begun a good work in each and every one of us. And Jesus is faithful to complete it. So it's not up to me to complete it. It's not up to you to complete it. It's up to Jesus to complete it, because he's the one that started the good work. And when we understand that it's up to him to complete it, then we stop trying to lean on our own understanding And we get to the point, we seriously get to the point to where we acknowledge him in all of our ways and allow him by his Holy Spirit to direct our pathway. This is so vital in the kingdom. It's so vital in the kingdom because we find ourselves continuously trying to do things man's way. God has already established his way. He's already established his will. And he's already established his kingdom. All of that has already been established. Then he has given us his, he has given us guidelines, words to live by. That if we live by these words, then the lives in which we live down here will be just as he ordained for us to live them, and that is in his Son. In his Son. Come on, I need you to stay with me. I need you to stay with me. Don't draw back. Don't fall off of this broadcast because I'm sharing something with you that's literally life-changing. I'm sharing something. That's why I want you to share this, because I'm giving you the meat of the gospel. I'm giving you the unadulterated truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ, because I'm reading it to you directly from the Word of God, and I'm expounding it to you by revelation of the Holy Spirit, as he's the teacher on tonight. And I'm sharing with you that it is all about Jesus. It's all in him. The writer of Hebrews, man, he nailed it. He hammered this thing home and shared with them and urged them and pleaded with them. Don't turn back to Judaism, because what you need and what you're looking for is not in the law. What you're looking for is in the grace of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. That's why it's in him that we live and we move and we have our very being. Everything that we need is in Christ Jesus, and everything that we need has already been supplied. The Bible say that he has already given unto us all things that, I'm feeling real good now, that pertains to life and godliness. And that's only in Christ Jesus. It's not in my education. It's not in degrees. It's not in my accomplishments. It's not in my reputation. It is in nothing that I have established. It's nothing that I have built. It's nothing that I have accomplished. Nothing. And Sheila, you're absolutely right. He is Jesus. He is the master builder. He's the master builder. If we can get that, and if we can allow him to be that in our lives, there's nothing like being built up in Jesus Christ. There's nothing like being rooted and grounded in Jesus, and then Jesus builds us up. The Word of God, our salvation, a firm foundation. And then we, as we grow in him, we receive revelation, wisdom, and knowledge, and understanding of the Word of God, understanding the ways of God. The Bible says this, Jesus say, learn of me. We've got to learn of him. And how do we learn of him? By getting into his Word. Why? Because faith cometh by not having heard, but faith cometh by hearing. And I teach a lot. Repetition, because that's how we learn. I gave you the analogy earlier, not tonight, but I've given you the analogy before. I grew up playing sports, and I loved sports. And our coach knew that we knew the game, but he wanted us to perfect the game. He wanted us to, when he called a play, he wanted us to be able to respond to that play without having to consciously think about it, because it's so ingrained in us. When he called the play, we're ready. Everybody on that field is ready. Everybody on that court is ready, because it has been so ingrained in us that when the play is called, then we automatically begin, everyone begin to go to their set place. A basketball court, everybody goes to their set place. Football, everybody automatically knows, I block this person, I block that person. If it's a receiver, I go and I run this route. Quarterback, I take two-step drop, a three-step drop, because it's been so ingrained. And so even though we run it, coach will say, run it again. And we're running, and he say, run it again. We run it, and he say, run it again, run it again, run it again. Why? Because he wanted us to perfect it. Why do I teach in repetition? Because I want us to get it, and I want us to be able to walk in it. I'm not trying to rush through anything, because this is not a marathon. I mean, this is not a sprint. It's a marathon. We live this life every single day, and if we're going to live this life the right way, we've got to be equipped with the right word. That's why the Bible says that we are to rightly divide the word of truth, that we will not be ashamed when we have to give an account. This word has to be rightly divided. So I'm going to take my time, and I'm going to build this word in us. I'm going to instill this word in us. And then as we begin to yield ourselves to the working and the leading and the guiding of the Holy Spirit begins to build us up in the things of God. And now we're no longer on milk. Now we're on solid food. We're on the meat of the word. And now we can teach what we have been taught. And then we see that the audio and the video begins to match up. And now we're walking in the unity of the Spirit of the living God. And this life is no longer tedious, but this life is glorious. And even though we may have opposition, even though we may have trials and tribulations, even though we may have aches and we may have pains, we are still living the Zoe kind of life, that is the God kind of life, because we are rooted, grounded, and established in his word. So the writer is urging them, don't turn back. And I'm urging you tonight, UFCC and friends and loved ones, I'm urging you tonight, don't turn back, because what we need is only in Christ Jesus. We live this thing. We live this. We live this. Verse number 7, wherefore, as the Holy Ghost saith, today if ye will hear his voice, harden not your hearts as in the provocation, in the day of temptation in the wilderness, when your fathers tempted me, proved me, and saw my works 40 years. Wherefore I was grieved with that generation, and said, they do always err in their heart, and they have not known my ways. Out of the Amplified, I want to read that same passage. Therefore, just as the Holy Spirit says, today if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as your fathers did in the rebellion of Israel at Meribah, on the day of testing in the wilderness, where your fathers tried me by testing my forbearance and tolerance, and saw my works for 40 years, and found I stood their test. Therefore, I was angered with this generation, and I said, they always go astray, where? In their hearts. You see that, Sister Sandra, Sister Pratt? They always went astray in their hearts, meaning in their hearts of flesh, in their mind, in their way of doing things, in their own understanding, leaning to their own understanding, they went astray. That's why it's so important for us to not lean to our own understanding. If we acknowledge him in all of our ways, we won't find ourselves going astray. Again, even though we go through the same thing that other people go through, we go through the same thing that those that are not saved go through. We go through backaches, we go through knee pains, we go through neck pains, we go through migraines, we go through frustration, we go through all of that, but we don't draw back. We go through grief, but we don't grieve as those who have no hope. For Christ Jesus is our hope of glory. So even in our down times, we're up. That's, oh my God. I want to say that again because I want us to get there. Remember, we've got to receive this in the spirit. Even in our down times, we're up because we're up in him, Christ Jesus, because that's where our hope is. Can we attest to that? That even when we're down, we still have hope, and our hope is in Christ Jesus, our Lord and our Savior. And our faith is still in him, and our faith is still towards him, even in our down times. Glory to God. And I said, they always go astray in their hearts, and they did not know my ways, nor become progressively better and more intimately acquainted with them. They didn't know the ways of God, and neither did they become progressively better and more intimately acquainted with them. God is a God of intimacy. God is a God. He's a jealous God. He's a God of anger. He's a God of wrath. When he see the hearts of his children going in the opposite direction that he desires us to go. Did he stop loving the children of Israel? Absolutely not. Did he stop providing for them? Absolutely not. They wanted manna. They wanted something to eat. He gave them manna. They got tired of the manna, and they grumbled and they complained about the manna, and he gave them quail. And geographically, quails didn't even fly close to the coastline of where they were traveling. And so God imported in quail. He imported in quail for the children of Israel in the midst of their murmuring and their complaining, and he satisfied them with quail. And then he gave them a pillar of cloud by day to cool them and to protect them from the damaging rays of the sun. And then he gave them a pillar of fire by night so that they would not be children of darkness. Jesus is our pillar of fire, that we have been brought out of darkness and into his marvelous light. I'm here to share with you, there is a far better covenant in Jesus Christ. A far better covenant. Okay, let's see if we can wrap this up. Glory to God. Where did I stop? Verse 11. Verse 11. So I swear in my wrath, they shall not enter into my rest. Take heed, brethren, lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God. He is really beckoning with them. Don't allow this evil to come in your heart, because it has to be something evil that will cause one to turn from the goodness of God and to want to go back into a place that held them in bondage, want to go back to a place where they were persecuted and prosecuted. There has to be an evil aspect of one's heart that will cause them to want to leave such a glorious and such a wonderful fellowship. And I submit that same today. This is the New Testament church that we're reading about here in the book of Hebrews. And the Bible tells us that Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. And for the writer to pin this to this group of people: take heed, brethren, lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief. Don't let there be in you, I won't let there be in me, an evil heart of unbelief that will cause me or give me a desire to depart from the living God. He goes on and he says this, still talking to this group of people, because look at it this way. If there was a group and their mindset or their thought was to return, to go back, if there was a group, it would lead me to believe that they were encouraging one another in this area. They were encouraging one another in this area to go back to the Judaism faith. I want you to see this, because look at where we're getting ready to go in the next verse. He said, don't have a heart of unbelief that will cause you to depart from the living God. He goes on, he says this in verse 13, but exhort one another daily while it is called today, lest any of you be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin. So since apparently these individuals got together and began to discuss going back, turning back, he's saying, instead of doing that, exhort one another. Exhort one another. Exhort one another while it's called today, lest any of you be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin. In other words, so you don't be hardened through this heart, this evil heart of unbelief. Unbelief is a sin. God sent his only begotten Son. That's why it says that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. So unbelief is a sin. That's why, therefore, there is now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. We're not called to judge those that are not in Christ Jesus because of unbelief. They are condemned already. So he didn't call us to condemn. Jesus himself said, he said he didn't come into the world to condemn the world, that by him and through him, the world might be saved. So if he didn't come to condemn the world, why would he give us permission to condemn the world? The world is condemned already by sheer nature of unbelief. So he's saying, rather than walk in that evilness of the unbelieving heart, exhort one another while it's called today, while right now there's an urgency in the matter. Exhort one another today while it is called today, lest any of you be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin. For we are made partakers of Christ if we hold the beginning of our confidence steadfast unto the end. child of God, stay until the very end. Let me read this to you out of the Amplified, and I think, let me read this to you out of the Amplified, and then I think we're going to be ready to close for tonight. I pray that you've gotten something out of this, as I always do. I pray that this is beneficial, and that you're receiving something from the study. Take care, brothers and sisters. I'm in verse number 12 of Hebrews chapter number 3, and I'm reading this out of the Amplified. Take care, brothers and sisters, that there not be in any one of you a wicked, unbelieving heart, which refuses to trust and rely on the Lord, a heart that turns away from the living God. Be continually encouraged, but continually encourage one another every day, as long as it is called today, and there is an opportunity, so that none of you will be hardened into settled rebellion by the deceitfulness of sin, its cleverness, delusive glamour, and sophistication. For we believers have become partakers of Christ, sharing in all that the Messiah, sharing in all that the Messiah has for us. We've got to stop living beneath where God desires us to live. And there should not be a shame in you for living well. There should not be a shame in you for doing well. There should not be a shame in you for being a prosperous people. There should not be a shame in you for not looking your age. There should not be a shame in you for not feeling your age. There should not be a shame in you for being able to remember way back when. There should not be a shame in you for your sight not dimming. There should not be a shame in you for your hearing not dulling. There should not be a shame in you for living on top with all things under your feet. Beloved, we are partakers in everything that the Messiah has for us. And so here I am now to you. Here I am now tonight saying unto you, beloved, get your inheritance. Live in Christ Jesus and live in the abundant life of Christ. He told us in John 10:10, he said, the thief cometh but for to steal, to kill, and to destroy. But I am come that you may have life, comma, and that life more abundantly. I need you to make up in your mind tonight. I need you to decide tonight which side of the comma you're going to live on. Are you going to live abundant life? I mean, are you going to live life, or are you going to live that life more abundantly? I have decided in my heart of hearts that I'm going to live the abundant life in Jesus Christ, because that's why he came. He came to save me from my sin. He came to deliver me out of the hand of my enemies. He came to lift me up in due time. If I humble myself under the mighty hand of God, he will exalt me in due time. He came to do that for me, and I'm not apologizing to anybody for living a good life in Jesus Christ. Woo, glory to God. I'm not apologizing for living a right life in Jesus Christ. Glory to God. He loves us with an everlasting love, and he has made us partakers in the things of God. Hold fast. I say to you, just as Paul said as he went about teaching on his missionary journeys, hold fast to that which I have taught you. Hold fast to that which you have seen me do and say. I want to be your example here in the earth realm. I want not only to teach and deliver this gospel to you, but I want to walk in this gospel, and I want you to see me walking in this gospel. So that when another gospel come before you, you know that it's a strange gospel and you know to flee from it, because what I'm sharing with you, I'm going line upon line and precept upon precept. I'm not swaying away from the word of God. I'm not giving you my opinion. I'm not giving you my my own analogy away from the word. I'm not taking his word out of context, but we're keeping it in context, because once you remove the text, then we're left with the con. I'm not here to con you, but I'm here to share with you the unadulterated gospel of Jesus Christ. So if you hear another gospel, beloved, don't you receive unto you that gospel. This is the gospel of Jesus Christ, and it's all about him. It's all about him. There is an urgency. There is an urgency. And I feel the writer of Hebrews. There was an urgency then to tell them to hold fast to your confession, to hold fast to what you have believed in and to whom you have believed in. And I say to you tonight, UFCC, I say to you tonight, guests and friends, I say to you tonight, hold fast to your confession of faith in Christ Jesus, our Lord and our Savior. Don't turn back. And don't allow another gospel to enter into your heart. Lean not to your own understanding, but in all of your ways, acknowledge him and allow him to direct your pathway. That's my prayer. That's my desire for each and every one of you. He's already gone before us, and he's already prepared a place for us that where he is, we will be there. We will be there also. And if you don't get anything else tonight, I want you to get this. We are already, not only are we partakers, but we are already seated together with Christ in heavenly places. We're seated together with Christ in heavenly places because we are spirit, soul, and body. May God bless you tonight. May God keep you is our prayer. Shalom, I love you. We thank God for you. And we give God praise for each and every one of you. Thank you so much, all of you, for joining us on tonight. Again, we missed you all. I'm so glad and I'm so thrilled to be back on. We needed that respite. It was great. For those that may not know, we went on a cruise. We cruised the Bahamas, St. Thomas, Virgin Island, St. Martin, Virgin Islands, and we had a wonderful time aboard the Wonder of the Seas. Amen. What a beautiful, beautiful, beautiful cruise ship. And we had the opportunity to fellowship with beautiful people, precious saints of like faith and like mind. One house, amen, for the entire week. We were all on one accord, amen, giving God glory and giving God thanks. And so we do the same for you tonight. We give God glory. We give God thanks for each and every one of you. You're wonderful people. You're quality people. And we love each and every one of you. Till our next time together this coming Sunday, 10:30 Central Standard Time, 262 Illinois Avenue, China Spring, Texas. Invite someone out. It's your church. Be proud of your church. Invite someone out to be a part of our in-person worship. Amen. And if you don't have a church home and you're tuning into this broadcast, we invite you out. Don't worry about the distance. Amen. Don't worry about the distance. Don't worry about the drive. It's worth the drive. I guarantee you. So come on out and be a part. 10:30 Central Standard Time, 262 Illinois Avenue, China Spring, Texas. We love you. We love you. We love you. God bless you. God keep you. Have a wonderful, wonderful night's sleep. We pray for uninterrupted sleep on tonight. Amen. And we'll see you Sunday. Glory to God. Have a good night.